Ambassador Baird, thank you very much. It is always very difficult for me to speak about Rick. Particularly, I agree with him on everything, including when he speaks about myself. But to be serious, we obviously owe a great deal to a number of people in this room who will be introduced separately and appropriately the way they deserve. So let me mention them as a group. Henry Kissinger, Brent Scowcroft, Hank Greenberg. This was a group who was put together in a different way by Richard Nixon. Of course, Henry Kissinger was Secretary of State, before that National Security Advisor. Brent Scowcroft was Deputy National Security Advisor and then went to do other great things. Hank was not in the administration, but was a friend of the President and an important informal advisor. When I read about Nixon, and I did not know Nixon, of course, when he was president, I met him only in the 80s. But when I read about Nixon, I hear very often, it's almost a cliche, how insecure that president was. And I will defer to those of you who knew him as president to have a judgment. I do know, however, how enormously secure he was intellectually. And it required indeed a very big man to put together an administration of giants, an informal kitchen cabinet of giants, which really helped him to formulate American foreign policy. And the way his administration has ended, let me use Nixon's own words, which he shared with me on a beach of a very unlikely place close to Riga, Latvia, Baltic Sea, back in 1992. And he said, Dmitry, I made real mistakes. I screwed up. And he said, the worst thing for which I blame myself is that we could not finish the job. And I think that was not just Nixon's tragedy. I think it was American tragedy. And it was also American tragedy that I think for many years we stopped talking seriously about American national interests and about American foreign policy. Charles Krauthammer wrote that we took in the 90s a holiday from history. Well, I think it's true, but actually it was worse. Because when you take a holiday from history, the assumption is that you take a holiday and then you come back home. And everything is nice. You are relaxed and you can do whatever is required even better with new vigor. We ignored history. And I am guilty among many others because now, of course, we are publishing the National Interest magazine. Where before we became involved with the magazine, that remarkable article was written, The End of History. And you know what is most interesting about that article? The brilliant editor of the National Interest, Owen Harris, thought that this was a stupid article. But because it was such a fancy idea in the early 1990s, a temptation was irresistible to publish, to promote, and then it became a cliché. History has ended. Well, you know, I felt very much at home, of course, in the 90s, because coming from the Soviet Union, I was taught that there is one theory, Marxism-Leninism, that communism was the end of the history of the mankind, that nothing bad is going to happen, and of course the Soviet Union would be a hegemonic force in the world. The Chinese ambassador is here, and the Chinese government even at that time did not quite agree with that notion. But otherwise, you know, some Brezhnevites would be very happy in Washington of the 90s with self-celebration, self-congratulation, and a constant reminder of how great we were and how we could walk on water without getting our feet wet. That is what our center from the very beginning wanted to discourage. I remember many things from President Nixon, but I particularly remember how he talked to other foreign leaders. And I will never forget a conversation he had with the Georgian president, Gamsakhurdia, who was the Georgian president at that time. And Gamsakhurdia came to see Nixon. It was in Tbilisi in 1991. And he said to Nixon, you know, Mr. President, the Soviet Union is in ruins, but that's not enough. The real problem is not the Soviet Union. The real problem is Russia. And one more push, and the Russian Federation itself is going to disintegrate. And I can be the agent of that change. And Nixon listened to him with his poker face, and then said to him, Mr. President, you know, there are all kinds of people in Washington who you are going to encounter. And there are people who will tell you what you want to hear. And there are also people who will tell you what you need to hear. I'm one of them. And what I need to tell you, that the United States is not going to war with Russia because of Georgia. What our center is trying to do is to remind people that decisions have consequences, that you have to ask yourself not only where you are going to be after your move, but where you are going to be after others, after your opponents do respond. And that policy should be judged not by intentions, but by results. If policy was judged by intentions, probably Jimmy Carter would be considered our greatest president. We, to put it delicately, were not always successful in persuading Washington to adopt our point of view. I'm trying to think what exactly we were able to accomplish during these years. I guess we had a panel on U.S.-Russian relations where a number of our distinguished board members were involved. Senator Hagel and Senator Hart chaired it, and we presented recommendations for a new approach to Russia, which kind of became known later as a reset policy. That term was not ours. We went to see General Jones, who was an, the National Security Advisor. Chuck Boyd was instrumental in making it happen. We went to see Secretary Clinton, and we were assured that we were having a major input in the administration policy. But you know what I have learned from memoirs of that great diplomat, Talleyrand, that normally governments agree with recommendations which they wanted to make themselves anyway. So what real impact we had on the administration policy, I have no idea. What I do know is that during these years, we tried to contribute to a debate raising difficult but necessary questions. And we tried to do it in a way which would be unusual, unorthodox, but at the same time, we never wanted to do it in a way when we would be peripheral. We tried to understand the state of play. We tried to present our arguments in a responsible bipartisan way. And one reason I think we were able to do it more effectively during recent years than before was because of the National Interest Magazine, which really became a major voice in American foreign policy debates. The same magazine which published and promoted the Fukuyama article, The End of History. Now I think that we're talking about history a little more respectfully and realistically. And the success of the national interest to a large measure is, I think, something that was accomplished by our previous editor, Bob Merry. I don't see you, Bob. Can you stand up? And Bob is a very distinguished presidential historian. He made a career decision to move to Seattle, but he remains political editor of the National Interest, and I have to say, a very important and influential columnist. His successor, Mr. Heilbronn, Jacob, could you come here? I think have continued Bob Merry's tradition of intellectual excellence and the kind of refining a true realist argument, but also helped the magazine a great deal in real outreach. And I think the magazine now is indeed an important, I shouldn't say indispensable voice, but a voice to be counted. And Jacob, perhaps you will say a couple of things about that.
Well, it's very kind of Dimitri to invite me to speak here, and I have to offer one slight emendation to his remarks about the end of history. I was an assistant editor, and one of the first pieces, the first piece I worked on was Francis Fukuyama's The End of History. And I think it's to the credit of the National Interest that the publisher at the time was Irving Kristol, one of the four, certainly one of the foremost intellectuals of the past century. And Irving wrote in his response in that very issue in 1989, he said, "I'm delighted to welcome G.W.F. Hegel to Washington, D.C." And he ended the essay by saying about Fukuyama's essay, "I don't believe a word of it." That, I think, embodies the spirit of the magazine, which attempts to provide a gamut of opinion grounded in a realist perspective, but we are always eager to publish essays, whether it's from people who lean toward the Democratic Party or the Republican Party, and that is, and it's also grounded in an analysis of American power. And at a moment when I think many magazines are either being terminated by their institutions or, if I may be so bold, dumbing themselves down, I think it's to Dimitri's and the members of the boards of the National Interest's credit that they're still willing to support a magazine that engages in pretty highbrow discussion of both domestic and foreign policy. And I think that decision was ratified this year again. For the third time out of 5 years, we're the only publication to win the award this often. We won the Real Clear World Best Opinion Sites of 2013 award. And the award said, while it is one of the must-reads of Washington's foreign policy community, its analysts are certainly not afraid to throw elbows at the establishment's cherished orthodoxies. I think that's got it exactly right. And I was going to begin my talk with an anecdote about Winston Churchill, but since Dimitri gave me such a good segue, I couldn't. But I think I'll end with it, which is that it's when Winston Churchill was in Parliament in the 1930s. He never had much enthusiasm for listening to rival orators, as he had a keen appreciation of his own abilities. And he even had less of a regard for socialism. And as one of the few female and socialist members from Liverpool was holding forth, he fell asleep. And she stopped and yelled and said, "Mr. Churchill, must you sleep while I talk?" And he replied, "No, madam, I do so purely by choice." And it is my devout hope that the National Interest, too, retains a Churchillian cast to it. While it may provoke, stimulate, or irk you, it will never, ever bore you.
Jacob, thank you. And let me end on a very fine note, particularly because we have the Chinese ambassador with us. When Nixon decided to create the center, he thought that the great challenge was, what do we do with the dramatic change in the Soviet Union, with Russia becoming independent? He talked about the United States winning the Cold War, but not quite winning peace. Today our challenge is a little different, but we are again present at creation. And I am thinking about, of course, first and foremost, U.S. relationship with China. Graham Allison from Harvard, from the Belfer Center, is here with us. And Graham wrote recently in the National Interest about what happens between great powers one of which is a status quo power, and another is a rising power. And Graham was not very optimistic about the historical record, but Graham was optimistic that with a combination of vision and common sense, we can do right this time. The only problem is, what happens if you have a rising power and a revisionist power? What if our neoconservative friends want, what if the United States decides to be a revisionist power, not just to maintain the fundamentals of the global system, but also to engage in global guidance and do it sometimes quite assertively? That is a very explosive combination. I am not suggesting that we should avoid defending American interests when it is necessary, but we should do it with open eyes and in the name of principles we believe in. I am not suggesting any prescription for policy. I am suggesting that our center has a lot of work to do. Thank you very much.